My title today is Why Study Literature, the Importance of Storytelling, and the Politics of Reading. And it's really in line with a lot of what John just said. I'm trying to articulate why I think English literature classes are important, why they've been important in my life to this point. And I'm also trying to connect it with other research that I've done, other thinking that I'm still working on, sort of throughout this talk. So I will begin. And like I said, it should be about, I think, 20 minutes or 25 minutes, and then we'll have plenty of time for questions if anybody has any. So in the past, I've always opened my introductory literature courses with two questions. The first, what is literature? And the second, why is it important? While these questions may seem fairly simple and straightforward, they tend to spur lively conversation and debate as the term progresses. The first question, in fact, has no easy answer. What is literature? To define literature is also to impose upon it a set of rules or primary characteristics. And literature, like all art, rarely conforms to expectations. More significantly, literary definitions often veil political imperatives, where elevating one author or genre over another also means endorsing one set of concerns or vision of reality over other competing perspectives. In this respect, literary canonization is a thoroughly historical and political process, one that can never be entirely exhausted by appeals to supposedly timeless aesthetic criteria. The second question is perhaps even more complex, as it reveals my personal stake in contemporary political contests over the future of higher education. When I ask, why is literature important, I anticipate a set of answers that will help validate my own courses. In many respects, it's a defensive question, one that only needs to be asked in an intellectual climate where serious doubts are being raised about the usefulness of a literary education. As the value of an education in the liberal arts is called into question, as funding is increasingly transferred from the humanities to the sciences, and as English literature courses are replaced by English composition courses, it is more important than ever to articulate why my classes matter. But I've slowly come to realize that the question, why is literature important, isn't really up to this task. In a typical literature course, my students and I come together to read a set of stories. When I argue that literature is important, I'm tacitly suggesting that the stories I've assigned for any given term are also important. But, and here is something I haven't always recognized, this doesn't make my course more valuable by association. One can certainly appreciate a good story without seeking out any of my lit courses. If the question, why is literature important, is designed to persuade, my anticipated audience is most likely a group of non-readers. I'm trying to let my students know what they're missing out on. But my students do read. They watch television, they go to the movies, they share stories about themselves and their lives on all types of social media. I realize many of today's television programs don't match up to Shakespeare. At the same time, I've already suggested that debates over literary merit are highly contested. And my broader point is that most of us value the stories we consume for one reason or another. When I ask, why is literature important? Then I seek to manufacture a type of consent that already exists. A better question, I've come to think, is why should we study literature? What's the point of getting together with a group of people to discuss stories? How do we benefit? After all, I'm not very worried that human beings will suddenly quit reading and writing stories anytime soon. But I can't imagine a future where courses in literature fall beyond the bounds of the most economical and efficient college education. It's also a more precise question. It isolates the type of work that can be accomplished within the classroom and attempts to articulate how it can be meaningful. No doubt this question has many different possible answers, but today I want to gesture towards one in particular. And as this early introduction is meant to suggest, My answer has everything to do with the relationship between politics and aesthetics. I should also state from the outset, when I use the term politics, I'm not talking about Republicans and Democrats. I use politics to refer to uneven relationships of power. If I'm interested in storytelling, I'm also concerned with what stories are told and who gets to tell them. So let me begin by sharing a story. A few months ago, my mom and my younger sister were shopping together at a mall in upstate New York. My sister, Annie, has a muscle disorder that prevents her from walking and speaking. So my mom was walking behind her, pushing her wheelchair. As they were walking, a woman approached them with a big smile and greeted them with an excited, almost theatrical hello. While the woman seemed familiar, my mom couldn't place her. She returned the hello, and my sister bounced back and forth in her wheelchair, smiling and laughing as she clapped her hands, her own return greeting. The woman then stepped forward quickly, grabbed my sister's hands, pushed them towards her lap, and told her to calm down in a much more serious tone. My sister was immediately quiet. My mom, taken aback for just a moment, then responded, "Take your hands off of my daughter." But the stranger wasn't flustered by the request. She released my sister, looked at my mom calmly, and said, "No, no, it's okay. I was a special education teacher, and I know how to handle children like this." When I first heard this story, I was most startled and disturbed by the fact that a total stranger would feel comfortable putting her hands on my sister. What appeared to me as an obvious violation of personal space was not so in the mind of this former educator. To her, I imagine Annie's visible disability offered an invitation of sorts, a unique opportunity to share her expertise with the mother of a disabled child. While I'd like to say that this type of scene is rare, it is far more common than you might think. People, most often current or former professionals who have worked with disabled individuals in some capacity or another, often feel comfortable approaching my sister, asking fairly invasive questions about her, and slightly less frequently offering suggestions for her personal improvement. I was a special education teacher, and I know how to handle children like this. Children like what, I wonder? My sister has an unidentified muscle disorder. It's so rare that it doesn't even have a name. As such, the official medical record actually knows nothing of Annie's disability. If her disability defies categorization, what does it mean to be a child like her? Disability studies scholar Rosemarie Garland Thompson explains how the presence of a visible disability can impact an otherwise typical social encounter between two people. She writes, "In a first encounter with another person, a tremendous amount of information must be organized and interpreted simultaneously. Each participant probes the explicit for the implicit, determines what is significant for particular purposes, and prepares a response that is guided by many cues, both subtle and obvious. When one person has a visible disability, however, it almost always dominates and skews the other's process of sorting out perceptions and forming a reaction. The interaction is usually strained because the non-disabled person may feel fear, pity, fascination, repulsion, or merely surprise, none of which is expressible according to social protocol. Besides the discomforting dissonance between experienced and expressed reaction, a non-disabled person often does not know how to act toward a disabled person, how or whether to offer assistance, whether to acknowledge the disability, what words, gestures, or expectations to use or avoid. Perhaps most destructive to the potential for continuing relations is the non-disabled person's frequent assumption that a disability cancels out other qualities, reducing the complex person to a single attribute." Thompson describes a fairly typical social process, noting how the presence of a visible disability can often disrupt the way individuals recognize and relate to one another. More significantly, she shows how a disability can easily be interpreted as the most salient aspect of an individual's identity. When we see a missing limb or a wheelchair, we freeze on that detail, and it can quickly become the only thing that we see. Something very similar is at work in the scene I just described, except that my sister's experience offers a somewhat more egregious example, because a special education teacher should really know better. In other words, one would expect an experienced professional to see the individual before the disability, and not vice versa. To speak of children like this, or really children with disabilities, is to use disability to unite a group of otherwise distinctive individuals, to elevate one category of identity over all the rest, and to treat this association as if it is the most natural thing in the world. But of course, there's nothing natural about such a grouping. The assumption at work here is that an exterior disability reveals something about a person's interior life. And this assumption allowed a stranger to feel comfortable in claiming knowledge of my sister's identity and exerting control over her body. It's also worth noting that my sister is not a child. She was 29 years old when this exchange took place. Referring to her as a child, though, at once denies both her adulthood and the autonomy we commonly associate with it. Maybe this was just an innocent mistake. I have my doubts. But regardless, it participates in a much longer history of cultural discourses that associate impairment, most often intellectual impairment, with childlike innocence and simplicity. And because Annie cannot speak, she's had to combat questions about her intellect for much of her life. When she was only 7 months old, a neurologist advised having her sent to an institution immediately. He told my parents that she would be a vegetable for her whole life and that she would ruin our family. Later, at the age of 7 years old, official school evaluations placed her intelligence at the level of a baby of 9 months. It took an outside evaluation from a local university before the school district was legally forced to acknowledge that Annie was actually well ahead of her class in both reading and math. And lest I be mistaken here, my point is not just that Annie's diagnoses were problematic because they proved to be untrue. These misdiagnoses suggest underlying problems with any medical or institutional narrative that would determine a person's worth, the whole value of a human being, based on such narrow appeals to physical and intellectual normalcy. So at this point, you might be wondering why I've chosen to share this particular story in a talk about studying literature. But I don't think it's as tangential as it might at first seem. For one, this story illustrates the critical practice of reading that guides so much of my literary pedagogy. Something we learn very early on in any literature course is that language is not a transparent medium. Just like real human beings, fictional characters often speak in codes, particularly when it comes to politically charged subjects. Racism, sexism, homophobia, they don't always announce themselves explicitly. As careful readers, we need to become adept at dissecting these codes, extracting key details from them, examining their deeper implications, and situating them within larger social, cultural, and historical contexts. We also need to pay careful attention to the actions of our characters, to how those actions are narrated, and to how they are interpreted by others. Finally, we need to acknowledge the silences and omissions that populate the margins of any text or speech act, to the words or thoughts that exist just below the surface of a scene, but cannot be spoken aloud. All of these considerations have gone into my reading of this simple social encounter between my mom, my sister, and a stranger. For as long as I can remember, I've been a protective older brother, so seeing someone put their hands on my sister would have always upset me. But for almost as long, I didn't have the critical vocabulary to contest this type of behavior in a meaningful and persuasive way. Of course, I'm bothered that a stranger would grab hold of my sister's hands and take control of her movements, particularly knowing how much she values her independence. But there's a deeper logic at work in this scene, one where a special education teacher felt justified in behaving this way. I can't begin to challenge this type of behavior if I don't first understand where it comes from. And if it seems like I'm moving too quickly from the study of literary texts to a discussion of an actual social encounter, I'm only trying to underscore an important point. This type of reading doesn't stop in the classroom. One of my favorite authors, Nigerian writer Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie, discusses the power of stories in a TED Talk titled "The Danger of the Single Story." As she explains, stories matter. Many stories matter. Stories have been used to dispossess and to malign, but stories can also be used to empower and humanize. Stories can break the dignity of a people, but stories can also repair that broken dignity. I agree with Adichie, but there's one thing I'd like to point out about what she says here. I'm not sure we can always tell the difference between the stories that empower and humanize and those that dispossess and malign. Take the example I've already provided. I think a former educator's decision to grab hold of my sister's hands and tell her to calm down is dehumanizing, but I'm sure she doesn't feel the same way. Part of this difference of opinion comes from the fact that we hold different beliefs when it comes to the treatment of people with disabilities, and our beliefs, I imagine, have emerged alongside very different narratives about disability and disabled individuals. When it comes to disability, in fact, there often aren't many flattering stories to choose from. Tiny Tim and Captain Ahab, victim and villain, offer the most common archetypes for disabled characters in the Western literary tradition. They elicit the limited emotional responses of pity and fear, respectively, both of which, I might add, can lead to dangerous consequences when acted upon in the world outside the text. I would argue that the special education's teacher falls in line with this much larger discourse of pity. After all, one must feel pretty sorry for another person if their initial instinct is to try to make them better. In the classroom, then, we read different types of stories written by different types of people. We put these stories in conversation with each other, and we try to put the assumptions they make under critical pressure. And often, we're taking note of those stories that empower and those that malign, because the differences can be pretty subtle. And I think, importantly, we don't always agree, which is part of what makes a classroom such a dynamic space. When I ask students to read literary texts politically, I'm really asking them to think about the relationship between these texts and the world outside of them. But no serious investigation into this relationship can ignore the uneven relationships of power that structure our lives. To study literature is also to study power. All stories are not created and distributed under equal circumstances. Some stories are told more often and find a wider audience for reasons that have little to do with artistic merit. The type of story offered, where and to whom it is being told, and who is doing the telling all matter. No doubt there is less at stake in the story I've shared today because my sister and my mother could move on from it unharmed. They went about their day and put the unpleasant social exchange behind them. But if you switch the terrain from the relatively equal ground of the shopping mall to a special education classroom, everything changes. In this setting, a teacher's decision to silence my sister would have the whole force of an institution behind it, which is virtually the force of a law. Where would Annie be able to find a voice if her efforts to communicate were consistently met with such disapproval? Her educational story would be written entirely from this other perspective. Annie's vulnerability is magnified because she cannot speak, but all students, myself included, have had to negotiate the uneven power dynamics that structure the relationship between teacher and student. Stories, whether fictional or not, provide a voice for some while silencing others. As critical readers and thinkers, we must always negotiate which voices are most important to us. Of course, as individuals, we are always implicated in the relationships of power that we study. There's no such thing as an objective observer. We come to stories with our own values, beliefs, and interests, and they often impact how we feel about what's being narrated. a literature course is not a place for enlightenment. It's not the instructor's job to tell students how to feel about a set of stories, to sort out the good ones from the bad. My politics do not become your politics. Nor is it a mere sounding board for the personal values and beliefs of our students. The process of reading involves a more complex process of identification. We recognize pieces of ourselves and our world in the literature that we read, and the reflections can be both flattering and unflattering, often depending on the context. The Italian Marxist theorist Antonio Gramsci writes, "The starting point of critical elaboration is the consciousness of what one really is, and is knowing thyself as a product of the historical process to date, which has deposited in you an infinity of traces without leaving an inventory. Reading stories, I would argue, allows us to begin taking such an inventory. It allows us to recognize the innumerable traces that have shaped us into the individuals we are today. And it helps us to make critical decisions about the types of individuals we want to be in the future." For Gramsci, this is a starting point for critical thinking. It doesn't take us outside of power, but it does help us recognize the political implications of our thoughts and our actions. As an undergraduate English major, I was often asked the question, what are you going to do with an English degree? And then, usually after a brief pause, teach? I always hated this question, and I'm probably not the best person to answer it since I did ultimately become a teacher. It's a practical question, and I don't want to diminish its significance, especially during a time when many college graduates find themselves entering a workforce that doesn't have room for them. It's worth thinking about how our courses and majors prepare students for the job market, and increasingly our students are demanding that we do so. But I'm also not willing to equate a college education with job training. The critical reading and thinking skills I've discussed throughout this talk have a variety of practical applications, but their value cannot be calculated by a strictly economic equation. We live in an age of misinformation. We need skills to sort through it and make sense of our world and our place within it. Stories can help, but knowing how to read them carefully and critically is also important. Our lives are defined in very real ways by the narratives that surround us, and we can't contest those narratives if we don't understand how they operate. Why study literature? Because stories can help us to imagine some possibilities while closing off the potential for others, and we all have a stake in determining which possibilities are most important to us. Thank you.